may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. The story is told of a man who died, and when he went to heaven, he found two lines in heaven. Now, you won't find these lines when you really make it there. It's a hypothetical story. He found two lines in heaven, and each line had a large sign over the line. One sign said, "All men who were dominated by their wives, stand here." That line of men stretched to eternity, infinity. It stretched for infinity. There were just so many men. The second sign read, "All men who have never been dominated by their wives, stand here." Underneath that sign, there was only one lonely man. So the man who was just arriving in heaven, he went over to the solo man in the line and he asked, he says, "What's the secret? How did you do it?" The man says, "To be honest, I'm not sure why I'm standing in this line. My wife told me to stand here." We have all heard jokes about who wears the pants in the family. But leadership in the home is serious business. Sadly, some men grew up without a good model at home, and as a result, some men struggle with what it means to be a good husband and a good father. But this morning, I want to share with you part two of a message I started on Mother's Day. And if you missed Mother's Day, you may want to go back into our website to review this message, Secrets of a Happy Home. I'm speaking on part two, Secrets of a Happy Home. On Mother's Day, I gave you a list of the five primary needs of a husband. And today I'm sharing with you the five primary needs of a wife. Now, gentlemen, fathers, those who are not fathers, those who hope to be fathers or hope to be husbands, I want you to know that the research indicates that these are the top five needs, the top five things that must happen. Guys, I hope you're listening. These are the top five things that must happen in a marriage for a wife to believe she has a great marriage. So, guys, if you want to have a successful marriage, you must get these five things right. Did you hear what I'm saying, guys? Guys, if you fail here, you have failed. And so I'm hoping that as we go through these five things this morning, that you will really give me your undivided attention. Now, some guys feel some guys put more effort into being a good dad than into being a good husband. You know that some men, because of how they were raised, they want to put more effort into being a good dad than on being a good husband. And I've said it before, and I'll say it again. Guys, the best gift you can give your kids is to let them see you love your mother. I'm talking in particular to guys who are married to the mother of their children. The best gift you can give to your children, and I say this without any contradiction, the best gift you can give to your children is to let them see you love their mother. Guys, are you ready? I'm going to invite guys, even those of you who don't normally take notes. This is so important. Take notes this morning. Grab a hold of the insert in the bulletin and you take some notes as we go along. Need number one, wives need to be cherished. Wives need to be cherished. In Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, the Word of God says, "Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her." I remember Brian Hugh Grant, take you Cheryl Angela Hart to be my wedded wife, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love, honor, and cherish till death us do part. I said it. To cherish. Do you remember your vows? Do you remember the day you stood at the altar and you promised and vowed to cherish your wife? So how are things going? How is the love going? Have you learned to cherish her? Our wives, guys, deserve, and I don't care whether you're children or not, your wife deserves to be cherished. Proverbs 5, 18 and 19 says this. Proverbs 5, 18 and 19 is going to be put on the screen, so you need not turn to it. Rejoice in the wife of your youth. Let her breasts and tender embrace satisfy you. Let her love alone fill you with delight. Some guys love that verse. Amen. They say, thank God I'm cherishing my wife. Amen. But listen, guys, if that's what you think it means to cherish your wife, you'd better think again. Your wife needs to feel special. She needs to feel that she's your treasure. Did you hear what I'm saying? Your wife needs to feel that she's your treasure. And this cannot happen if you're not spending quality time with her. So I'm going to say to you guys, to you husbands, you have got to slow down. You cannot cherish your wife while you just keep moving. It takes time. So slow down. And here is a key. Go back with me to Ephesians chapter 5, and let's read from verses 28 to 31. We're talking about the fact that we need to cherish our wives. It says here, so husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but what does he do to his flesh? Here's what the King James and the New King James says. He nourishes and cherishes his body, just as the Lord does the church. And the Word of God is saying, husbands, in the same way you nourish and cherish your own body, you need to learn to nourish and cherish your wife. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, of his bones. Listen, it is saying this is what Christ does to his church, because the church is his body. Verse 31, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and shall be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. I was teaching the Bible study just 2 weeks ago in my class, and we were going through these verses. And while I was teaching, it hit me. I had never paid attention to this before. Why should I love my wife as much as I love my own body? Husbands, are you awake? Why should you love your wife as much as your own body? Because she is your body. You never miss that. You see, we have no problem accepting that the church is the body of Christ. But what he is trying to get, the same way the church is the body of Christ, Your wife is your own body. This is what God did in a mysterious way. He has brought the two. He says in verse number 31, and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. God has made you one flesh. Your wife is your body. Guys, do you take care of your wife as much as you take care of your body? Are you as concerned about your wife as you are concerned about your own body? I believe if we took these verses seriously, it would help us to care and be tender and loving and attentive to our wives more than we are right now. It would make us more willing to sacrifice. Oh, that's a word. That's a key word, sacrifice. Oh, you'll sacrifice for your own body. And God is trying to help you and I to understand as men that in the same way we would sacrifice, the same effort we make to take care of our own body, we need to put the same effort. We need to consider her. And guys, I am trying to say to you this morning that it is critical if you are going to succeed. Oh, I hope somebody's getting what I'm saying. If you are going to have a successful marriage, you must cherish your wife. You must treasure her. You must put priority on her. But I want to take a look at another aspect of this whole issue of cherishing. Because there is something that's happening that is damaging our ability to cherish our wives. The second half of verse 19, we just looked at verse 19 of Proverbs 5, and it's still on the board. If you notice, the last part says what? Let her love alone. Did you see that, guys? Let her love alone fill you with what? Guys, can we talk? If we're to cherish our wives, we've got to keep away from anything that gives sexual gratification other than our wife. We've got to guard ourselves from pornography. I'm going there. Some people, I preached a series on marriage, and I know it made some of you uncomfortable, but I am going to preach anything that's in the Bible. Pornography is big business. It's a $97 billion industry. It is everywhere. In April this year, Time magazine said that one out of every five Google searches are for porn. Did you hear what I said? One out of every five Google searches are for pornography. I know that this morning, as I shared the word of God, there are men sitting here who have a problem with pornography. He said, Brother Brian, how are you so sure? In 2014, the Barner Group did a survey, and they found that among men who said they were Christians, 55% said they were addicted to pornography. Did you hear what I'm saying to you? For those who said they were born-again Christians, the number was 27%. Did you hear what I'm saying? When 27% of men who say they are born-again Christians say they are addicted to pornography, we have a problem. Guys, we need to deal with this. Parents, it's sucking in our children. Time magazine and some of the other material that we can access tells us that our boys are being exposed by age 8. I am sounding an alarm for you parents who are putting these cell phones into your 9-year-old children's hands without any guidelines, without any safeguards, and you're giving them internet access. I am warning you that you are setting up your boys. And girls, I'm coming there. The porn industry knows. You see, the problem is, and I'm going to get back there before the message is finished. The church is starting to follow the world. And everything everybody else's kids have, my kids have to have it. Everybody's child has a television. Listen, when we were our children, nobody has no TV in their room. I want to know exactly what the children are watching. There is one computer. It's in the kitchen. I want to see what everybody is going on and Googling. And I'm saying to you parents, he made you a parent. He made parents before he made children because he expects you to be more responsible. Amen. Somebody say amen. But whether you're single or married, pornography is not okay. You see what happens, the world is, it is so common. Spoke to a young lady the other day counseling, and she said to me, she said, Brother Brian, I'm surprised you're making an issue of pornography. She says, growing up, every young man I knew was into pornography. I just thought it was the normal. Oh, this is a Christian person I'm talking to. She said, I thought this was the normal way life is. And it is so common that often we think it is okay. But listen to what Jesus said in Matthew's Gospel chapter 5. I think we have that also. Matthew's Gospel chapter 5, verse 27, 28. We're putting it on the screen, but you make sure you have that in your notes. Here's what Jesus said. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I tell you that anyone who what? Looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Are you trying to understand? Pornography. Listen, adultery is not just the act of adultery. Adultery is when we are looking at a woman in a lustful way. Oh, there's so much I could say, but I'm going to control my some of what I say, because some of it will make you more uncomfortable than I want to make you. But suffice it to say, young people, older people, Jesus was saying pornography is not okay. It's a sin against God, and it's a sin against marriage. I'm going to give you one illustration of how it's a sin against marriage. Do you know that the experts are now finding out that prolonged exposure to pornography is resulting in a significant rise of erectile dysfunction, even among men under 40. That men are married and cannot meet the natural needs of their wives because they have been so exposed to pornography. The effects of the fake are so powerful that it has rendered the real useless. This is a crime against God, and it's a crime against your marriage. And young men and older men, I am challenging you this morning. It is impossible. Are you with me? It is impossible to cherish your wife if this is what you're into. I want to say, son, let's be careful. Because sometimes our wives innocently help us along. Our wives, there's a movie she wants to see and she rents it or she takes us. And there are all these naked women in the movie. And she doesn't even realize she's setting up her husband. Girls, wake up. There is something in a man that when a nude woman appears, it does something in the brain. Christians ought to have some standards. There ought to be some non-negotiables. There ought to be some things we will not watch. No matter how everybody else is telling us how great this movie is. Lady, wife, don't set your husband up. By the way, this is no longer a male problem. Women, get this, are now the fastest growing porn users. Did you hear what I'm saying? Porn users. The fastest growing segment of porn usage is now coming from women. And I'm going to suggest to you, my dear sisters, please be on guard, because the devil is trying to make us ineffective. As I researched this, I was just so blown away. Some guys have given up marriage. Some guys don't even want to date. Why bother? Go to all the trouble of calling somebody up and inviting them to a date when I can have all this pleasure by myself. And it's in the church. 28% of born-again Christian men. I encourage you. If you're guilty, stop. Because you know this thing is addictive. Now, young people, don't get started. I hope, I'm talking to some who are not married yet. Don't go down that road. It is addictive. But I want to talk to the guys who are, or the ladies who are. If you're addicted, if you realize you cannot help yourself, and I've been talking to people who say, listen, Pastor, I cannot help myself. I need help. I hope you're praying for us as we seek by God's grace to help those who have need. Because being frank, some of the problems that come are beyond our human ability. Amen? But we want to help you. The problem with pornography is that many men and women who are into it are ashamed to come for help. But if you're addicted, the studies show it's almost impossible to resolve it on your own. You need an accountability partner to help you. And I just want you to know, if you come to us, we will keep it confidential. We're not going to be broadcasting your story all over the press. We will help you. And if you come to us with it could be that your accountability partner approaches us. You may talk to another brother and have them be accountable to them. They can come to us. We will give them the material that we are using so that you can be a help. But bottom line, I am saying, guys, we cannot keep going on this path. Somebody say amen. Amen. The second, wives need communication. I spoke on that much longer than intended. Wives need communication. One of the main reasons marriages fail, and I'm going to ask right now while I'm ahead for 10 minutes of grace, because it's evident that I'm not going to get finished at 12:30. You're going to have to give me 10 minutes of grace. Can you give me 10 minutes of grace? Listen, what I'm talking about to me is so important, I cannot just leave it half done. So ladies, you need to give me some grace, amen? One of the main reasons marriages fail is because of poor communication. The worst form of loneliness is to live with a spouse and still be lonely. Can you imagine? A woman is married to a man and she is lonely because there's almost no communication with the man. That's the worst form of loneliness. I'm in the house with you, but I'm lonely. Some years ago, it was reported that women speak about 20,000 words a day, while men speak only 7,000 a day. So some husbands came home and they said, by the time I get home from work, I've already spoken my 7,000. So I have no words left for you, honey. I'm sorry. My 7,000 are up. I know you still have 13,000 left. You can talk by yourself. Well, guys, sorry to burst your bubble. A later study found that women speak 16,215 words a day. I'm getting this from the universities and some of the... 16,215. Not 14, 15. And men speak 15,669 words a day. So we're almost neck and neck in reality. So guys, we actually do have enough words to communicate with our wives. Amen. We actually can. We have enough words. Write these down. It's not in your notes. Write these. There are five things I wanted to go very quickly. Five things you need to remember that can help your communication. Number one, remember, communication is more than just talking. It's about understanding the emotions and the intentions behind what is shared. Amen? Did you get that? It's not going to be on the board. So I say you got to write this down. It's about understanding the emotions and intentions behind what is shared. You got to understand the emotions and the intentions, because your wife needs to know she was heard and understood. Guys, that means you'll have to pause the TV and give her your undivided attention. Ladies, am I right about it? Not just the aha, aha, and back to the TV. Am I right about that? Guys, you are going to have to pause it or shut it down so that your wife knows she was heard. Because you need to understand the emotions and the intentions. Second, you can do things to facilitate communication. I can't quite understand how some guys never ever do anything. Some of us are so into our children. That we forget we didn't marry them. You didn't stand before an altar and vow to cherish your children. But you stood before God and vowed to cherish your wife. How dare we put her aside and say, my focus is my children. How dare you do that and think you are honoring God? So when last you decided to take her out for soup and salad? I'm trying to be low cost here. You see, you don't have to always take her out to... So years ago, I was counseling a gentleman, and he said to me, because I was trying to encourage him, he says, brother, whenever I take out my wife, I got to have $300. I said, my goodness, why you got to have $300? I got to take her here. You know, it's like them children. You know, one of the things I noticed when we were raising the children, we would buy all these wonderful toys. and they play with them for 5 minutes, and then they go right in the cupboard, pull out some of the pots. You ever had that? Anybody ever had that happen to them? You got all that fancy stuff. They said, just give me a pot. All I need is, I just bag that pot. Your wife don't need a steak at Fleming's. Is that the name, Fleming's? I mean, you can take her there if you can afford it. But if you can afford soup and salad, take her for, listen, even skip the soup and just go with the salad. Take her to a nice restaurant if you want to, and just give her a cup of tea. Take her to Rita's Water Ice. Guys, here's all I'm trying to say. I hope you're getting the message. Set up opportunities. I don't understand it. I do must tell you, I do like taking her out. We do stop at Rita's Water Ice. We all the stuff. Yes, sometimes we go for a little nothing. Guys, how is it you don't take, want to take your wife out? Why is it the kids always have to go with you? You. I better stop. I hope I'm communicating with somebody today. I hope I'm communicating with some husband today who will say, you know, it's true. I really could do more, just me and my wife, to create an environment that facilitates communication, just me and she. Third, how you say something is more important than what you say. Did you hear that? How you say something is more important than what you say. I have to give you these because I didn't, the Lord gave me this late, so I didn't have it on the notes, okay? How you say something is more important than what you say. Guys, did you realize that 55% of a message is non-verbally communicated? 55%, and that 35 is communicated by the tone of voice. 55 is nonverbal. 35 is the tone of voice. So how much does that leave for the actual words? Mathematicians, I'll tell you, since you're taking long to add, 10%. Only 10% of your message is the actual words you said. No wonder so many of us guys end up in the doghouse, although we said the right words. You see, there, guys, there's a difference. Your wife says, honey, would you do so-and-so, so-and-so, so-and-so? There is a difference between saying, aha, versus, aha. You getting it? There is a difference in the way you say it. One makes it, what a chore, what a burden. I'm not sure I'm going to really do it. That, uh-huh. Next thing you know, you're in a big squabble. How you say it is more important than what you say. Number four. Learn the art of saying the right thing at the right time. Learn the art of saying the right thing at the right time. Here's what Proverbs 15:23, as I talk about learn the art of saying the right thing at the right time. Proverbs 15:23, I think we have that one on the board too. I'm not sure, but if we don't, I'll just read it for you. It says here, Proverbs 15:23, everyone enjoys a fitting reply. It is wonderful to say the right thing at the right time. Oh, you didn't know this was right in the Bible, huh? Proverbs 15:23. It is wonderful to say the right thing at the right time. And guys, I'm going to give you a secret. Our wives don't always want a solution. Do you hear what I'm saying? Because, you know, as men, your wife, you know, oh, by the way, guys, can I confess? All of what I'm sharing with you, I'm a work in progress. I've learned a lot. So some of what I'm sharing is because I've learned. But by God's grace, I'm a work in progress. As the little song says, little by little, every day, Jesus is changing me. Guys, ladies, by the way, this message is not designed for you to take any of this to your husband. I want to be clear. If any of you decide, you have all the notes, I'm going to pull it out. And you didn't hear what Brother Brian said. I can guarantee you, you are in trouble. You know, I've been saying from this pulpit a number of times that sometimes we forget that we can speak to God. And sometimes we're so determined for change, we rush ahead and we love to pummel the poor little man on his head. Talk to God and say, God, please help him to hear. Please help him to respond. Talk to God. Have hope. God is able to bring hope. Fifth, be gentle. We have heard, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words can never hurt me. It's a lie. Words hurt. Proverbs 12:18, the words of the reckless pierce like swords, but the tongue of the wise brings healing. Harsh words kill communication. So practice using words that are gentle and affirming. So what have we said so far? Wives need to be cherished. Wives need communication. Wives need honesty and openness. They need husbands who are transparent. And by the way, wives, you also need to be transparent. This is not a one-way street. Some marriages, it's the wife who won't communicate. The husband is trying to get out his 16,000 words, and you aren't using up yours. All right? So sometimes it's the other way. But wives need honesty and openness. You know, let's look at Genesis chapter 2, because there's something here that I think is very important. Genesis chapter 2, verse 24 and 25. And you might say, what in the world does this have to do with anything? Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. There we go again. And they were both what? Naked, the man and his wife. And they were what? They were naked, but not ashamed. And then you go to Genesis chapter 3, verse number 7. Then the eyes of, verse 6, so when the woman saw, verse 6 of Genesis 3, so when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they what? Sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. Isn't it interesting? Just a few verses earlier, they were naked but unashamed. Sin enters, they were naked. We better hide. I can't let him see me. Suddenly, this couple started hiding things from each other. The minute sin enters, and to this very day, husbands and wives are hiding things from each other. And so, some husbands and some wives, they make sure that they hide the passcode from their phone. Does your husband or your wife know the passcode for your email and your phone? I'm going to suggest that you let them know. You see, we should be open and transparent. Anything you have access to, your wife should have access to. Why isn't she? In fact, to be honest, all of my email, other than, you know, there's an email account I have. There are some accounts that doesn't run right through to my wife, but others have access to it. But there are some that if she wanted to go look at it, she really could. And I just want you to know that we need to have this transparency. And then, of course, I remember before we got married, somebody came to my wife and they said to her, Cheryl, you need to make sure you have a little bank account. That Brian don't know about. You got to hide some money from. By the way, she's a Christian. You see, Christians, it doesn't mean because somebody's a Christian, they don't give you some bad advice. This lady was actually telling my wife, don't be open, don't be transparent with your husband, because, you know, you really can't trust a man. I wonder why you marry a man you don't trust? We're afraid to be transparent, to be completely, we are afraid. 1 John 4:18, perfect love casts out fear. And it is my prayer that those of us who are married will make a renewed commitment to transparency, to have a relationship that's open and honest. So, miss, sister, husband, if there's that money you're hiding, go home and confess it. Fourth, wives need husbands who are committed to family. Wives need husbands who are committed to family. Your wife wants a husband who is committed to her and the children and will assume his responsibility in the home. And God expects the same. Number one, guys, we have got to learn to manage our family. 1 Timothy 3. In 1 Timothy 3, Paul is addressing the elders, but what his advice to the elders is good for all men. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 4 and 5, Paul says that he must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him, and he must do so in a manner worthy of respect. And I'm here to tell you, you know, all of these topics I could have spent a whole day on, but that's not how God has worked it out. Even if you have a strong wife, and boy, I tell you, we sometimes need to just talk about that. How to lead your family when you have a strong wife. Men, we better have a men's breakfast soon. Some of you guys need to get together and help us organize this. We need to work through some of these things in a little more detail. How do you handle? But listen, that's no excuse. You see, sometimes you are a manager at work and you have some team members who are difficult, right? What do you do? Do you go to the boss and say, boss, it's not my fault. I got all these difficult people. What do? You have to find a way to work with the difficult people and to motivate and inspire them. Guys, don't come and say, oh, if you only knew my wife. God knows your wife. And he says, manage your family. Lead your home. Don't be one of these husbands who like to plant his feet firmly in midair. It is a tragedy that too many men are gradually taking more and more of a back seat and saying, let my wife do it. That's not God's way. But let me talk to the tough. Are you a tough wife? Are you one of those difficult wives? I don't want you to raise your hand. But if you are, I beg you, help your husband to lead. This is God's way. Second, not only learn to manage your family, but get involved with your children. Get involved with your children. I can't develop this morning, but let me leave two quick skeleton points. Train your children. Train them. Train them. Proverbs 22:6 says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he will not depart from it. Train up a child in the way he should go. And I will tell you this, I am more and more concerned that young families are more and more following the way the world is doing it. Let me give you one illustration. This is just one illustration. There was a time that Sunday was the Lord's day. Today, the world has convinced the church, the world has convinced young families that if my child is not involved in this and this and this and this and this, they won't make it. So we're running, run, 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 run. And I'm going to ask you, who are you trying to train this child for? And I'm going to challenge every parent in this congregation to make Sunday. Let's return that Sunday is God's day. It's the Lord's day. Raise your children recognizing Sunday is the Lord's day. You will not be, you see, you're not going to hurt You say, but they're going to miss this. You're not going to hurt. God is no man's debtor. You will never do anything to honor God and be sorry you did it. Let me say that again. You will never do anything to honor God and regret that you did it. But you will do a lot of things. You will do a lot of things that your neighbors and the community. Let me tell you one of the craziest things I've ever heard. There's a new movement blowing in the Christian evangelical church, and a lot of these seminaries are pushing this, what they call missional approach to spreading the gospel. And part of the missional approach is that we must get more and more involved, more and more involved in the community. But here, let me give you the one that I think is crazy. So some churches are actually telling their members, you know, probably you shouldn't bother come to church on Sundays anymore. It would be so much better if you took your kids and got them involved in all the little leagues and the this and the that and the other. Just think of the wonderful opportunity you had to share the gospel. I am like, God doesn't need me to go against his word to spread the gospel. So guess what? We take the kids out to church and we get so caught up in the game. No gospel got shared. After a while, we don't even bother to go to church ourselves. All right, let me quit quickly. What did I say? Train them, discipline them. Proverbs 13:24. Oh, I know the society tells you this: you shouldn't do this. Proverbs 13:24. It's still in the Bible. Whoever spares the rod hates their children. Boy, that's some strong language. Do you know the Bible says that? Whoever spares the rod hates their children. But the one who loves their children is careful to discipline them. Let's be careful. Let's be careful. Don't just, and by the way, don't start swinging the rod. Particularly if the kid don't even realize you love them. You haven't even played a game with them. You've done nothing. But no, we want to beat them. You can't beat me until you love me. Show me some love. This, by the way, some of the islanders, this is part of the challenge islanders have, because they left their children for somebody to care for them. And the child shows up in America after you're gone for 14 years. And you say, you know what, him? You're my child. The child is like, where were you for 14 years? You better develop a relationship. Learn to love the child. Oh, I can't go anymore. Final point. Wives need husbands who will provide financial support. You know what that means, so let me not even say anymore. 1 Timothy 5:8, anyone does not provide for his own, and especially for those of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. I'm about to close. I was in bed one night this week, and it struck me that if the points I shared are valid, you know, I like to test my messages to make sure they are biblically accurate. And I said, if the points I'm going to share are valid, they must also apply to the relationship between Christ and the church. And when you go home, you check it out. You'll find that everything I spoke about, Jesus showed in his relationship with the church. Go home and check it out. Everything Jesus modeled in his relationship with the church. But I want to just share one before I quit. Matthew 13:46. If you want to turn there, you can. I'm going to quit, I'm promising you. This is a second quitting, but I'm going to quit on this one. Matthew 13:45-46. Here's what it says. It says, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls, who when he had found one pearl of great price, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Jesus cherishes us. Do you know who is that pearl of great price that he found? You know, sometimes we look at it reverse and we think, as we found Jesus. It's talking about Jesus finding us. And Jesus, come, listen. Jesus is actually saying, I cherish my church so much that despite how messed up they were, he went and sold everything he had. Left heaven, came to earth, went to the cross, died for our sins. The Bible says, when he had found this pearl of great price, he went and sold all that he had and he bought it. I am loved. I am cherished. And I want you to know, my friend, it doesn't matter what you have done. Listen, you can cash in on the benefits. Did you hear what I said? What I'm talking about is how Jesus feels about his church. And you can cash in on all these benefits. I wish you'd get a little jealous and want to get a little taste of what God can do in your life. He cherishes us. He loved us. He died for us. He died for you. He wants to cleanse you. I wonder this morning if there's somebody here who said, you know, Pastor, I haven't even started with Jesus. He's not my Savior. He's not my Lord. He doesn't live in me. But I'm so glad that you're telling me that he's willing to change me. That's exactly what I'm saying. He's willing to change you. He's willing to come into your heart. He's willing to save you from your sin. It's up to you to say, come into my heart. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Every head.